नमस्कार, लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, वेलकम टू कैनेडा इंडिया फाउंडेशन वर्चुअल वेबिनार स्पीकर सीरीज, द सिक्स्थ ऑफ इट्स काइंड। टुडे वी हैव विद अस एन एमिनेंट यंग मिनिस्टर फ्रॉम इंडिया, ऑनरेबल अनुराग ठाकुर जी। ही इज सर्विंग एज अ मिनिस्टर ऑफ स्टेट फॉर फाइनेंस एंड कॉर्पोरेट अफेयर्स इन द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया। वी आर डिलाइटेड टू वेलकम यू सर। Anurag ji, on behalf of Anurag ji, on behalf of all the Indo-Canadians, I wish to congratulate you and the Modi-led Prime Minister Modi-led Indian government for taking the historic decisions such as the abrogation of Article 370, resolving the issues of Ram Temple in Ayodhya, and strengthening the institutional framework by incorporating robust reforms in all the sectors. Friends, Canada-India relations have not yet kept to its fullest extent and potential, despite of the fact that both countries share common values of democracy, pluralism, multiculturalism, rule of law, and more importantly, influential people-to-people ties. Canada is a home to over 1.9 million Indian diaspora, which is entrepreneurial, professional, politically and socially active, and integrated with the main scheme to serve as bridge builder between the two nations. Canada India plays that role in building that bridge. The democracies working together is our tagline, sir. Without further ado, I would like to have Satish introduce Canada India Foundation to you. Satish, please go ahead.
Thank you, Anil Bhai. Good morning, Honorable Minister, His Excellency. A very warm welcome and thank you for joining. And I also want to acknowledge the presence of our Consul General of India in Toronto, Shrimati Apurva Srivastavaji. Thank you for joining. A quick snapshot on Canada India Foundation, Minister. CIF is over a decade and a half old not-for-profit organization. Formed by a group of like-minded people to promote and strengthen Canada-India ties. They all carry a very deep love, passion, and commitment for Canada and India, and that is our energy and fuel to continue our work. Through CIF, we endeavor to capitalize on the success of over 1.6 million strong Indo-Canadian in creating some kind of a meaningful impact in the society. And we've been hosting various forums on the sectors of importance. In the past, we have hosted agricultural, mining, infrastructure, food processing, healthcare, higher education forums. And in May 2021, once again, we are hosting a very big Canada-India biotechnology conference with the specific focus on biotechnology, artificial intelligence, and post-COVID in partnership with Consul General of India in Toronto, FICCI, and UHN. We have also been recognizing outstanding individuals who have shown global leadership vision with Global Indian Award every year. And past year, our award recipient was the former Prime Minister of Canada, Honorable Stephen Harper. We also have a philanthropic arm, and we've been raising and donating funds to families of the fallen soldiers in India and Canada. And during this COVID, our members worked tirelessly to distribute free Indian vegetarian meal to frontline workers. And I'm very proud to say that we served over 15,000 meals, provided financial assistance to international students and stranded Indians in Canada. It's a very rare privilege and honor to have you, and we look forward to this very thought-provoking session. Thank you.
Thank you, Satish Bhaiya. I would like to have our High Commissioner Ajay ji, please welcome Anurag ji, and at the same time give us a few comments.
Thank you very much, Anil ji. Welcome to the Honorable Minister from India, Anurag Thakur ji, Anil Shah ji, Satish Thakur ji, Ritesh Malik ji, and Pankaj Dave ji. Thank you for organizing this wonderful event. I think the Canada-India Foundation is doing a remarkable job in bringing these young, dynamic voices from India, from the political field, from the business field, and exposing them to Canadian audiences. I think this is a wonderful service that you are providing. I'm delighted that we have Anurag Thakurji today with us. He's been multiple things. I'm sure you will. Your introduction will talk about his background, but he's not just a minister. He's been a cricketer, a cricket administrator, a member of the Territorial Army, and one of our most dynamic young ministers, the next gen ministers whom we talk about. I think what I would do is just make a couple of points about the Indian diaspora here, just to let the minister know what a wonderful, unique Indian diaspora we have. We have Indo-Canadians whom we number at about 1.6 million. Apart from that, there were some 700,000 people of Indian origin who are present in Canada today. And this is a unique diaspora. It has strong leadership positions in business, in politics. We have 22 members of parliament. We have four ministers. And in many ways, it's providing a unique kind of dynamism to Canadian society, and also providing a unique kind of leadership to Canada in politics, in business, in culture. And we see this relationship as having dramatically been helped by this push given by the Indian diaspora. As you know, we are going through a strategic transformation phase in this relationship ever since 2014, and the current Indian government took over. Prime Minister Modi visited Canada in 2015. We declared this a strategic partnership. Soon after, Prime Minister Trudeau visited India in 2018. And this transformation of the relationship is now seen in the financial sector very clearly, apart from various other sectors. Canadian investment in India by the major Canadian funds used to be $5 billion in 2014. Today, it is over $50 billion. So effectively, Canadian business is showing a vote of confidence in the Indian economy, its medium-term and long-term prospects. And I could also mention that we have multiple other ideas on the table, including the working on a Foreign Investment Protection Act, which concerns the Finance Ministry treaty between the two countries. And this would, again, provide a solid boost to the kind of investments we have. So we really look forward to listening to the Honorable Minister, but thank you, Canada India Foundation, for putting it together. Thank you.
Well, welcome. Can I please ask Ritesh Bhai, if you could introduce the minister?
Thank you. Namaskar, everyone. Honorable Minister of State for Finance and Corporate Affairs, Mr. Anurag Thakurji, Honorable High Commissioner of India in Canada, Ajay Bisriyaji, esteemed members of the Canada India Foundation, and other dignitaries and friends who are present today for this session, a very warm welcome to you all. I've been given this difficult task to introduce a man who has accomplished so much at just 45. Anurag Ji is a youth icon, a true visionary, and a leader of the new India. He's a four-time MP, which allows me to call him a veteran in Indian politics. His story of leading from the front started at the age of 17. With a bat in his hand, he captained Punjab to their first national level Cooch Behar Trophy. He was the highest run getter in junior cricket that year. Of all his illustrious achievements, deep in his heart, I know scoring runs still give him the most satisfaction. I'm sure about it. At the age of 25, when everyone around him saw a hill and a barren field filled with boulders, he envisioned the most beautiful cricket stadium in the world. HPCA Stadium Dharamshala is the cornerstone of Anurag Ji's vision, mixed with intent, passion, and perseverance. I would urge the members of CIF to visit this monument of hard work at some point. Under his able leadership as the youngest president of the BCCI, India also delivered an outstanding ICC World Cup T20 in 2016. on the political front, he shook the conscience of India for the cause of Kashmir by taking the pledge to hoist the national flag at Lal Chowk in Srinagar in January 26, 2011. And with the most number of questions in the Indian Parliament, he has always been at forefront in performing his duty as a humble servant of democracy. Winner of the Sansad Ratna Award and the youngest ever party whip in the Parliament, he is someone that we all can take inspiration and learn from. And now, under the able leadership of Honorable Prime Minister Modi, who is surging India ahead to claim its rightful place as a global leader, Anuragji is one of his most trusted soldiers. Talking of soldiers, Anuragji's heart beats and bleeds for his country as he is a lieutenant colonel in India's territorial army. Be it the idea of mobile hospitals, which he brilliantly executed in his constituency's hilly terrains, or giving children from small villages the opportunity to explore the world with Sansad Bharat Darshan, which CIF also is part of, Anuragji's ideas are dynamic and in sync with the unique challenges of the modern world. In a nutshell, what is perceived to be an obstacle, Anuragji sees as an opportunity. I have tried my best to introduce Mr. Thakur, but you all can understand his achievements are massive and it's very difficult to fill an ocean into a bucket. Mr. Thakur, we look forward to welcoming you and the children from your constituency in Canada soon. Over to you, sir.
Anuragji, please go ahead. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Anilbhai. His Excellency High Commissioner of India to Canada, Shri Ajay Ji, Chairman Canada India Foundation, Shri Anil Shah Ji, Member CIF Board of Governors, Shri Ratesh Malik Ji, National Convener CIF, Shri Satish Thakkar Ji, National Co-Convener CIF, Shri Pankaj Dave Ji. Thank you for inviting me to speak at the Canada India Foundation today. While my relationship with the foundation is a few years old, India and Canada have shared historical ties since the 19th century, when Indians began migrating in small numbers to British Columbia. Today, over 1.6 million persons of Indian origin who comprise over 3% of the Canadian population are fueling the engines of growth in your economy and are also the pride of India. As trade and commerce has grown, so far has our interaction between people to people and governments. After a gap of nearly 42 years, India's Prime Minister made a standalone visit to Canada in the year 2015. Prime Minister Modi made Canada a priority within a 1 year of his term in office. I would like to emphasize this because this is the significance we attach to our relations with Canada, which are powered by the vibrant Indian community present there. Prime Minister Modi visited Ottawa, Toronto, and Vancouver. He held extensive discussions with Canadian political leaders and also addressed 10,000 PIOs and Friends of India. The visit was also historically significant for another reason. As His Excellency High Commissioner has rightly said, because it was in April 2015 that our two countries agreed to elevate the bilateral relations to a strategic partnership. Our two sides cooperate in the field of space, railways, civil aviation, biotechnology, healthcare, atomic and nuclear energy, education and skill development, agriculture, trade, defense, counterterrorism, etc. Today, even the world grapples with the COVID-19 pandemic. Prime Minister Modi conveyed and gave an assurance that India's productive capabilities in the pharmaceutical sector would remain available for assisting the citizens of the world, including those of Canada, and to the best of India's abilities. And if you see, India is the fourth largest producer of the generic drugs. And even during this pandemic time, we have sent close to 160 countries hydroxychloroquine. Even during the pandemic times, when India needed it the most, we were at the forefront helping our other citizens across the globe. During this pandemic, both our leaders have discussed the possibilities of international collaboration to address the health and economic crisis. They agreed that the India-Canada partnership can be a force for good in the post-COVID world for advancing humanitarian values in global discourse. India has also emphasized the need to strengthen multilateral institutions, including the WHO, and agreed to work closely together at various international fora on health, social, economic, and political issues. COVID-19 has indeed unsettled the world, disrupted supply chains, and made us rethink and reimagine the way we work and our lives. Despite the adversity facing us, India has decided to turn this into an opportunity. Nabi Modi ji bar bar kehte hain, hame chunautiyon mein bhi avsar dhoondne hain. And also, let me narrate to you how India announced the Atmanirbhar package to the tune of 20 lakh crore rupees, which is close to $255 billion, which was close to 10% of our GDP. Atmanirbhar Bharat is the vision of a self-reliant India that creates value and wealth for all, accelerates growth, integration, and opportunities for Indians and the world at large. Global economic resilience can be achieved by stronger domestic economic capacities. This means improved domestic capacity for manufacturing, restoring the health of the financial system, and diversification of the international trade. Prime Minister Modi also gave a clarion call of an Atmanirbhar Bharat while inviting companies from around the world to come and invest in India. Since 2014, our government has been focusing on improving India's ease of doing business and making the business in India as per the global standards, making the business environment conducive for foreign companies to come and invest in India. In 5 years of Modi government, India's ranking of in the ease of doing business jumped from 142nd place in 2014 to 63rd position in 2019. India earned a place among the world's top 10 improvers of the third consecutive year. India, along with other top improvers, implemented a total of 59 regulatory reforms in 2018-19, accounting for 1/5 of all the reforms recorded worldwide. Since the opening up of our economy in 1991, India never had a resolute exit mechanism for companies. And we had a SARFAESI Act and the DRT, which we call the Debt Recovery Tribunals mechanism, which took close to 4 years for a resolution and resulted in only about 25% recovery. In 2016, we enacted Insolvency Bankruptcy Code, which brought a paradigm shift in debtor-creditor relationship and their mindset as well. The onus is now on the creditor to use the borrowings judiciously. If not, the lenders can take them to the NCLT, which is the National Company Law Tribunal, and they can lose their company. The overall recovery rate for creditors has jumped from 26.5 to 71.6 cents on the dollar. India now is by far the best performer in South Asia on this component and does better than the average of OECD high income economies. Since 2014, we have consistently brought down the income tax rates to the OECD levels. Last year, we announced a historical corporate tax rate cut, which is the single biggest direct tax reform in the country in the past 15 years. Domestic companies will be required to pay only 22% tax while foregoing any deductions and exemptions. Domestic manufacturing companies will be required to pay just 15% tax. Only 15% tax which will provide huge boost to Make in India initiative of our government. These rates are one of the most competitive rates in the world. The corporate tax rate cuts will have a twofold benefit. One, they will be required to pay a reduced corporate tax. Two, they will not be any more required to claim exemptions and deductions, which merely increase compliance. And that is why when I say about the ease of doing business, we are trying with each passing day how to increase our capacity and improve our rankings as well. In order to smoothen the process of imports and exports in India, we introduced a contactless process called Turant Customs. Importers will avail benefits with the elimination of routine interface with the custom officers, which will provide uniformity in assessment across the country. We have also made our taxation system simpler through faceless assessments and faceless appeals. This brings greater transparency, swiftness, and seamlessness into the system. Moving on, FDI has been critical in strengthening capital flows to India. In the first 5 months of this year, we have had FDI equity inflow to the tune of $17.59 billion, in spite of pandemic, reaffirming that India remains one of the most attractive destinations to invest. Further, as per the latest Global Investment Trend Monitor, India is among the top 10 host economies for FDI inflows, 8th in rank to be precise, thus driving FDI growth in this region. The world is well aware of Prime Minister Modi's push towards digital India and love for technology. And in today's COVID era, where our office has become work from home, that may be for just 7 days. But though I've been working during the pandemic times, not only me, even Prime Minister Modi is working for 18 to 20 hours a day. And if you could see the global companies here in India, also the multinationals and the local companies, many have moved from work to work from home. Eating out has been replaced by food delivery. Buying groceries and making payments has become contactless. We realize the impact of Prime Minister Modi's vision. In fact, India has witnessed a digital revolution. In the last 3-4 years, UPI symbolizes that the best. In July 2020, UPI recorded an increase of 11%, and the transaction reached 1.49 billion in July with a transaction value of 2.9 lakh crores. We have been talking about this, not only us, but the global companies. People who are visiting from across the world has been asking us the reason behind the success of UPI. We have been taking financial inclusion measures since 2014, and Prime Minister Modi expressed on 15th August 2014 during his Independence Day speech that he wanted every Indian to have a bank account and announced the Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana. Yesterday we completed 6 years, just yesterday. And we have crossed the landmark of 40 crore Jan Dhan accounts, 400 million Jan Dhan accounts, bank accounts, which have a cumulative balance of 1.3 lakh crore rupees. Over 50% of the account holders are women, and majority of the accounts come from the rural India. There has been a massive digital and financial inclusion revolution in India. And this is, my friends, is the opportunity and market the world is desperate to tap into. Another major initiative is a national infrastructure pipeline, which has a sanctioned amount of 111 lakh crore rupees and will enable a forward outlook on a large scale social and economic infrastructure projects. Earlier this month, We have launched the NIP portal, which is the National Infrastructure Pipeline portal, allowing investors to view the complete details and opportunities available to them at the click of a button. Under the Atmanirbhar package, we announced fast-track investment clearance through an empowered group of secretaries. Further, there will be a project development cell in each ministry to prepare investable projects. We also announced that the new disinvestment policy will notify strategic sectors in which at least one PSU will remain, along with private companies being allowed. So, for example, if there are five public sector enterprises, there will be one strategic and one non-strategic sector. In the strategic sector, there will be minimum one PSU. Rest will be privatized from time to time. Non-strategic sector will be fully privatized from time to time. We announced our intention to allow private companies for commercial mining of coal on revenue sharing basis. In the mineral sector, we announced that we would be enhancing private investments, and Prime Minister Modi launched that. We saw a huge response, more than 1400 applications in just a couple of weeks time. In the sectors of defense production, atomic energy and space, we announced our intention to open the sectors and inviting private companies on board. So you could see more investment coming in the field of defense, atomic energy and all that. We announced a list of production for the defense equipments. That means those 100 plus items will be manufactured in India only. So that will give more incentive to those who will come and invest in India, manufacture in India and export from India. Further, in sectors like agro food processing, this is the right time to invest. The Indian rural economy has been going through a strength to strength. With the formalization of economy, we will see more rural towns being connected to the supply chains of goods and services. This is the right time to invest in the logistics sector. Our intention is to provide a seamless logistic connection for our manufacturing units, starting from the manufacturing unit to road, rail, air, and ports. The physical infrastructure will be supported by a robust digital clearance framework that facilitates trades and accelerates growth to further enable ease of doing business and to improve the regulatory environment. We have been announcing steps to decriminalize the company law defaults, and we have been shifting compoundable offenses to an in-house adjudication mechanism. There has been a withdrawal of more than 14,000 prosecutions under the Companies Act 2013. In the recent budget, we have announced that we will be permitting direct listing of securities by Indian public companies in permissible foreign jurisdictions. We have also set up International Financial Services Center at the Gift City. We call it IFSC Gift City, which is in the Gift City Special Economic Zones in Gujarat, wherein we already have foreign banks, financial institutions, insurance companies operating. We have announced 10-year tax holiday in IFSC and commodity trend and commodity transaction tax, stamp duty, dividend distribution tax, long-term capital gain tax have been waived off. Let me also briefly mention about our new education policy, which has come after 3 decades, which is a forward-looking and has come into effect after years of deliberations and stakeholders' consultations. We intend to make India the hub of world's largest skilled workforce. I'm emphasizing here, we have right intentions, and Prime Minister Modi has a vision to make India the hub for world's largest skilled workforce. I want Canada India Foundation to come on board. As Riteshji earlier said, that I have taken a few projects in my constituency, which has been an eye-opener for many. from mobile medical units, treating more than 300,000 people in less than 2.5 years, free primary checkups, free distribution of medicines. That is one of the projects. At the same time, meritorious students have been given more exposure and experience. And I'm grateful to Canada India Foundation for inviting them to Canada to see and get more exposure how the world moves. In this field of skilling people, as globally there's a huge requirement of skilled manpower, I'll request Ajay ji, our High Commissioner, to also look at the numbers Canada requires so that we can train them, make them aware of the requirement of Canada, so they are attuned and customized as per the requirements of Canada. Not only Canada, but other parts of the world as well. India invites the world to invest in our growth story and become partners of equitable growth and development. With a stable political environment, strong and robust macroeconomic indicators, huge supply of cheap labor and skilled labor, digital penetration, a huge domestic market up for grabs, the opportunities are endless. And this is the optimum time to invest in India. I'm saying it again, this is the optimum time to invest in India. India offers a perfect combination of openness, opportunities, and options. And let me elaborate. India celebrates openness in people and in governance. Open minds make open markets. Open markets lead to greater prosperity. That is why I say, invest in India, make in India, assemble in India, export from India. We have incredible India, and is an incredible India is an incredible partner as well. Let me assure you and say with confidence that Modi government means business in a world where it's not business as usual. So let me request my friends from Canada, through the Canada India Foundation, and I request my High Commissioner also to let us see more opportunities, the areas of growth between both the nations, both the democracies. We have a lot to share, a lot of areas to grow together. I have been hosting many leaders of Canada in the past. They may be in opposition today. They may be in power at some time, but let me just say, India, Canada has a long way to go together. And Canada India Foundation can play an important role. We need more contacts, more deliberation from people to people, organization to organization, industry to industry, and government to government. I have been taking many delegations to Germany and US in the past. In my last 4 terms as a member of parliament, I've been leading those delegations. And I've seen this interaction makes a lot of difference. It gives you insight during the informal discussions, how we feel about each other. And from there, we can take it forward. Not just as a minister in Modi government, but as a friend of Canada, let me assure you, I am available 24/7, 365 days, if I could be of any help for my Indian friends living in Canada or any Canadians who want to invest in India or to travel to India. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Anil Bhai, thank you for giving this opportunity. And let me assure you, you have invited few Himachalese meritorious students to visit Canada. I will look forward with the help of Canada India Foundation to set up a skill institute and to train thousands of Himachalis who are very honest, hardworking, train them and motivate them to go and work in Canada as well. At the same time, Canada is also starting doing well as far as the cricket is concerned. Cricket has been so close to my heart, as Honorable High Commissioner has said, and Ritesh also mentioned. I am still a cricketer at heart and a cricket administrator at heart. Let me assure you, whatever I could do to promote cricket in Canada, I think this soft power of India can bring both the countries together. Yoga can bring both the countries together. Our soft power of yoga, Yunani, Siddha, homeopathy, this can bring us together. Our khadi, handicraft, handloom, our tea, coffee, you know, these may look a smaller things, but when you wake up and you have an Indian tea on your bedside, Indian coffee on your bedside, and if you have khadi products to use during your day, I mean, it makes a lot of difference that you embrace Indian products and India. Let me once again thank you, and let us see how we can have more opportunities to work together and to have more dialogues between Canada India Foundation and other leaders from India or maybe the industry leaders. Thank you once again for inviting me. Thank you. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
What a wonderful speech, sir. What a wonderful presentation. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Such a beautiful words. Sir, आपने जब पहले क्रिकेट की बात करते हैं, एक जमाने में यहाँ पे सहारा कप होता था टोरंटो में, ऐसा कोई कप यहाँ पे भी शुरू हो जाए वापस दोबारा, हमारे लिए तो कैनेडियंस, इंडो कैनेडियंस एंड ऑल द क्रिकेट फैंस विल लव इट। मेरा एक सबसे पहला सवाल
है सर, इस पे अनिल जी, इस पे मैं एक बात कहना चाहता हूँ
प्लीज।
क्रिकेट के लिए आप जो कहेंगे हम लोग उसके अवसर देख सकते हैं क्या किया जा सकता है, क्योंकि अगर आप देखेंगे अमेरिका में भी आज से 3 साल पहले केवल 1 महीने के नोटिस पे हमने वेस्ट इंडीज और इंडिया के मैचेस करवाए और पूरे अमेरिका के लोग उसे एक डेस्टिनेशन पे फोर्ट लॉडरडेल मियामी के पास वहां पर इकट्ठे हुए और पैर रखने की जगह स्टेडियम में नहीं थी। इसलिए मैं कहता हूं कि हमारे पास सॉफ्ट पावर बहुत बड़ी भारत के पास है, हमें इस पे देखना चाहिए कि हम लोग क्या क्या कर सकते हैं। इसलिए मेरा निवेदन रहेगा कुछ भी ऐसा होता है तो बताइए, उस पर कुछ वर्क करते हैं और हाई कमिश्नर साहब को इन्वॉल्व करके और बाकी देखते हैं क्या क्या किया जा सकता है।
डेफिनेटली, थैंक यू सर। आई हैव वन हेल्प व्हिच आई रिक्वायर फॉर कनाडा इंडिया फाउंडेशन एंड फॉर दी आवर फ्रेंड्स इन द आर्मी। सर, वी हैव अनाउंस्ड द $40,000 डोनेशन टू गो टू द गलवान फैमिली विक्टिम्स फैमिलीज। However, we sent the $40,000 and the money came back because they cannot receive the money in foreign currency or even in the Indian rupees. So, if we can help in this, it would be a great help because we are already working through the Defense Attache and our High Commissioner, Defense Attache in Washington. We tried everything, but the money went, it came back. We would like to get this money to those people. If you can
assist. This money is for a noble cause.
Yes,
and I'm also attending a program tomorrow evening organized by one of the TV channels Z for the Galwan family members only.
Mm-hmm.
So I appreciate your help, and whatever is required from the FCRA clearance that goes through a couple of channels from the Home Ministry to others. So
yeah,
we have to go through that process. But I assure you my help, whatever best I could do, I will try and help you.
Thank you so much.
Because this is for a noble cause.
It is, sir, indeed a very noble cause, and this is why we all Canadian, Indo-Canadians have raised this money. Okay, now there is a big list of questions, so I will be very quick and I'll appreciate if you can, because you are short of time. Hamare paas time ki koi problem nahi, but we have about 20 minutes, sir, from you. So the first question is, what influence will US Democratic elections outcome have on Canada-India relations?
The government comes and government goes. The relationship carries on.
Right.
I still remember many countries were not even giving visas to one of our topmost leader. But now, leader of the world come to the airport to receive him.
Absolutely.
So you have to lead by example. I think you have to get into a position where, I personally feel, that is my motto in life, that you can't demand respect, but you have to command it.
Agreed.
So I think India is in a position to have good relations with any neighbor as well as any country in the world. And we have been doing that since the World War I to till today.
Lovely.
Ajay is a better person to respond on that because external affairs should be in a better position to answer that. But he's there with you. He can connect with
right. Ajay ji ke saath baat kar sab kyunki aapka time bahut kam hai. So we have another question, very interesting question. Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement, CEPA as it is known, have been going on since 2008. Signing of this agreement will open up a number of avenues for Canada, Canadian businesses to open their businesses in India and accelerate the growth of bilateral trade and investment. We would like to know if any further progress is made on that front.
On which front, NLG?
On CEPA, Canada. A comprehensive economic partnership agreement.
I think there are a lot of issues which at certain times, you know, some issues could be pending from the Canadian side, some could be from our side. Ajay will be in a better position to answer that question. Ajay, would you like to pitch in for that?
Go ahead, Ajay ji.
Do you think the High Commission?
Ajay
ji, you are on mute.
Ajay ji, you are mute.
You have to unmute, Ajay ji.
Okay, I'm back. I'll just give a quick answer to that. Piyush ji, who's a colleague of Anurag ji, has been in constant conversation with his counterpart, and we are looking at new and creative ways of moving forward with our economic agreement, the trade agreement. And we are very confident that we will make a lot of progress in both this agreement and the investment protection agreement, because we are already in conversation with the Canadian side. There are some complex issues, but we are confident that we'll deal with them.
Thank you, sir. The next question is a very interesting question, Anurag ji, aapke liye. With the anti-China fever prevailing in the world, do you think India has a chance to become the manufacturer to the world and compete with China? Or do you think the manufacturing sector will move to Vietnam and or Thailand?
Let me just say this, it's not about an extraordinary situation. When Prime Minister Modi talked about self-reliant India, that is to become more competitive in the global picture and to be part of the global value chain. So whether your sentiment is against one country or another, we have to be more realistic about how India could be more useful in getting more in manufacturing unit here and could become an exporting nation of the world. It can't be because of there is a sentiment against one country or another. We have the capability, we have the resources, whether it is a human resource, skilled manpower, or the natural resources. The only issue is the one thing that our leader is leading from the front. And that is why he said that India has to become a $5 trillion economy by 2025 and $10 trillion economy by 2030. And if you look at the last 5 years, we have jumped from 11th place to the 5th place as far as the global economy is concerned. This clearly shows that we are planning well and executing well. And that is why I've invited and given you the options, which areas we have opened up. Reforms we have brought in during the pandemic times. Even when the people were locked down, they were working from home. Prime Minister Modi was working from 18 to 20 hours and bringing in reforms to get more investments from outside and getting more public sector enterprises to become more private and get more investments and make them more professional. They were earlier also, but to become more competitive as well.
Thank you, sir. A very follow-up question to that, somebody has just asked me, does India allow Chinese Communist Party to invest in India?
I think if you look at the policies, those are very, very clear. There are certain agreements which are bilateral. There are many in a multilateral world. You work as per the WTO guidelines. But there are many options where each nation, whether it is Canada, US, India, or any other country, where they look at safety and security of their country in certain areas as well.
Fair enough. So this is a question is related to cricket. Why was Vivo IPL sponsorship put on hold until January and not cancelled outright? Is BCCI hoping that people will soon forget and it can go back to the Chinese sponsors as if nothing ever happened? Can we ever take a long-term approach rather than short-term or quick fixes?
See, BCCI is not a government organization. They promote sports in country, so they can answer this better. I cannot answer any questions on behalf of Indian Olympic Association or the Board of Control for Cricket in India. I will be answering on behalf of Government of India, especially questions related to my department.
Fair enough, sir. Anuragji, a gentleman has asked this question. Is there any plan of State Bank of India investing in Canada to increase its equity in its Canadian subsidiary, which will help the highest number of international students from India and large chunks of immigrants of Indian origin to add the help to trade finance the medium, small companies doing major businesses with India? We already have ICICI Bank functioning, but the State Bank used to be doing it, but has been reduced dramatically.
Arunji, on the other hand, we see the Canadian Pension Fund, which has invested in India.
Yes.
Whether it is the Kotak Bank or many other such companies, they have invested. Even they have come on board for the NIIF, which clearly shows that the investment is growing as far as from the Canada side is concerned. And that is why I said we have to look at the areas of growth and the areas of interest so that the investment should increase, whether from the Indian companies who are investing overseas or the Canadian companies who are willing to invest here. I can assure you, the Canadian Pension Fund, which is increasing their investments in India, will be getting good returns. And I think that is why they're increasing their investments. But there is a huge scope if you look at the National Infrastructure Pipeline Project, which is 111 lakh crore rupees project, which is to be spent over a period of 5 years, in the next 5 years. It clearly showcases that into the infrastructure kind of projects, there is a huge scope to come and invest. The returns should be great. So I personally feel there is a lot of opportunities to invest in India.
Okay, thank you, sir.
And yeah, as far as investment in one of the companies, as you said, I think it depends from institution to institution, company to company. Looking at the viability and they take a call from time to time.
Fair enough. Canada has a very robust developed technology in building and running smart cities. How do you see the collaboration between Canada and India can help in fulfilling the dream of Prime Minister Modi for developing 100 smart cities in the world, in India?
I think we have seen a visionary Prime Minister, Mr. Modi. And if you look at, 5 years, 6 years back when he emphasized that every Indian should have a bank account, which did not happen in seven decades, he was able to do that in 2 years' time. In the pandemic time, when globally, few developed countries could not transfer money into the accounts, in India, we have transferred thousands of crore rupees seamlessly into the accounts of millions of Indians. Not even one complaint. That clearly shows that he is looking at digital India. Look at the UPI, which is a beautiful platform, and there are billions of transactions happening every month. Now, at the same time, Anilji, while answering, I forgot about a question.
How do you see the collaboration between Canada and India can help in fulfilling the dream of Prime Minister Modi for developing 100 smart cities in India?
Yes. So I was coming to that his vision of having 100 smart cities. Now you see many countries and many cities coming on board and partnering with various states and the union territories. and the work is in progress. And I think Canada can do wonders in collaborating and coming up and executing with the smart cities in the coming years as soon as possible.
Okay, thank you. In the light of recent developments of COVID-19 pandemic, the economy is slowing down. Prime Minister Modi in his Independence Day speech emphasized on self-reliant India. How Indian diaspora in general and especially Indo-Canadian diaspora can contribute to the vision of Prime Minister to make it a reality?
I think, Anilji, in my opening remarks, I addressed most of the issues. And I've talked about many areas from defense to agriculture. Agriculture, I must say that we are investing close to 1 lakh crore rupee to create the agri infrastructure at the farm gate. Whether it is for storage or for the cold storage or for the refrigerated trains to refrigerated transport vehicles. So that is to save the 40% wastage which happens for the perishable goods. So similarly for others like defense, we are one of the largest, not one of the largest, we are the largest importer of the defense equipments. But at the same time, we want to become a production hub, defense equipments. And we have come out with the first list of 100 plus items which will be manufactured only in India, won't be imported. So that clearly shows how you can partner, especially to the field of space. We have done many others. And when it is becoming commercially viable, being opened up, former ISRO chairmen and former scientists have openly praised Prime Minister Modi that they have been waiting for last 4 decades for this decision. This clearly shows that we will see a lot of investments coming. We have seen many Indian companies showing their interest to invest into the atomic energy sector, nuclear energy sector, space sector as well. And looking at the Elon Musk or his experience as well as the Tesla to SpaceX and many other such experiences, I think we are bound to get a lot of investment in these sectors as well.
We would definitely wish that, sir. Next question is, considering the cost of collection, shouldn't there be no income tax, or rather income tax be zero for the next 10 years? Again, these are the questions that there should be no income tax for the next 10 years. Since the collection cost is far more, the overheads of the income tax department are way too high. This is the question coming.
If that could have been the case, even the previous government could have taken any decision on that.
Anybody could have
taken. Where do you get your revenue from then?
Well, I cannot say, I cannot answer that question.
Globally, every country is collecting the revenue from the direct or the indirect taxes. So I think if you have to progress, if you have to invest into the infrastructure and provide facilities to millions of Indians who still live under the poverty line, you need resources, and resources come from taxes. And we want more people to pay taxes,
absolutely,
maybe less or more, so that we can contribute some or large amount, small or large amounts, for the growth of India. And I'm grateful that under Prime Minister Modi's leadership, it has grown many folds, the number of taxpayers.
Sir, there is one quick question on the totally different subject, but there was a time when somebody, Prime Minister Modi, had raised the question. The logistics is one of the major challenges in India. And there was an issue came about that we in India do not use the waterways that we have, you know, to transport goods and products. Is there anything that is happening in that front?
You know, India has already started developing those waterways from Varanasi to Kolkata is the first phase what we have started, a couple of more. You will see in the coming 5 years, you will see a lot of areas where a lot of transportation from ports to hinterland and within the country also will happen through waterways, because it costs you 1/4 of the other options you have, whether it is rail or road or air. So that is why you will see a lot of waterways coming up, and a model transport system where you will have a connection between waterways, airways, roadways and railways, so that the northeastern sector, the east of India, will be far better connected with the rest of the country, with the ports and other areas. You will see a lot of investment coming into that areas, and there is a lot of opportunities, as well as I see a lot of growth in those territories as well.
Okay. Thank you, sir. One quick question. Another one is, any update on UCC, Uniform Civil Code? Personally, I don't understand the question, but I have to ask what I've been asked.
Let me tell your viewers, Prime Minister Modi has delivered which India was waiting, or large Indians were waiting for last more than 6 decades. Whether it was abrogation of Article 370 or 35A, or it was right for the Muslim woman by passing the bill for the triple talaq. At the same time, Indians were waiting for Ram temple. That has been fulfilled in a way. The foundation stone has been laid. Citizenship Amendment Act, which has helped thousands and thousands of minority who have come from Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Bangladesh, who are waiting to get the citizenship in India, who have been harassed, marginalized in those countries, and have feared for their life, and have come to India, migrated to India, and were waiting for one or two generations to get the citizenship. Even that has been fulfilled by Prime Minister Modi. Prime Minister Modi is known for fulfilling promises. And whatever we say, we deliver that.
That's very good, sir. There's one quick question on the other front, is going back to your, probably to your revenue department, sir. The imports of raw materials that are not manufactured in India, shouldn't that be considered critical for the Indian industry and the import duty be zero?
There is always debate on this. For example, I can quote to you. For example, furniture. If furniture worth hundreds of crore rupees has been imported every year, well, you rightly say, there should be zero duty on locks. There should be zero duty on planks, which is the cut pieces, planks and all that. But there should be duty on furniture. This is what people say. So that you have more value addition once you get the logs or planks into the country and you manufacture furniture out of it. But in certain areas, there's a very valid logic. But in many areas, for example, steel, you have huge steel capacity here as well. But if you also have a bilateral agreements with certain countries who have an advantage to send material to India, where on certain products, they may not have a duty. But at the same time, your local industry also suffers. How will you have a base here? How will you have raw material within India? For example, if you have coal and bauxite available, why can't you have more aluminium industries here? Why can't you have more raw material here? That is why we have come out with more reforms, that the auction for coal and bauxite can go together, so that we can give advantage to the aluminium industry as well. So these kind of reforms has been taking place in the pandemic times also, to give boost to our local raw material, not only to export millions of tons iron ore every year, but to add value to that and supply the finished good. So here is a challenge, whether you have to go step by step, and for that we are planning that how to give boost to the local manufacturing industry. There should not be enough burden on them. If the material is not available locally, they should not be paying enough on the import duty. But if the material is available local, then how we can make the local industry more competitive so that they can compete with the imported raw material as well. So we are working on both the lines to make India a self-reliant country.
Now, to expand on this specific question, since you mentioned about the steel industry, see, there are two specific products and which relate to my business. It's not that I'm selfish interest that I'm asking you, but nickel and stainless steel scrap.
I won't hold you for conflict of interest.
No, thank you, sir. The thing is, these two products are never produced enough. Nickel is not produced at all. And that is the biggest raw material for the stainless steel industry, which is a booming industry right now in India, despite the COVID times, because they being located in the rural India. Why is that import duty never been made zero? Ferronickel, for instance, that is also a very important raw material. Coming from Indonesia, there is zero duty, but coming because of the IFTA, but coming from rest of the world, they have to pay about 3% duty, which makes it totally not competitive at all. And India is the one who's suffering, the consumer, the industry is suffering.
RLG, as I said earlier, though Commerce Minister will be in the right position to answer these, but still, let me just say this. In certain bilateral agreements, you have certain agreed norms. So they have an advantage of that. You have an agreement with the Asian countries as well. So certain have advantage for that as well. But from time to time, various FTAs take place, bilateral agreements take place. There are WTO norms also where the multilateral trading system takes place. So I think it varies from industry to industry. Let me just tell you, is America or the United States open to import it from Canada? They also have levied duty in the name of security for the steel products. Not only from Canada, from across the world. So I think many countries have to look at the safety and security when millions of people are dependent on certain things. Then you take decisions on in the interest of the country as well.
Fair enough. How does the Indian government look forward to collaborate with Canada in context of promoting higher education? Changing the subject altogether, sir.
Which regulation, sorry?
How does the Indian government look forward to collaborate with Canada in context of promoting higher education?
Higher education. As I said, that the national education policy has a lot of options now. And that is why I mentioned during my opening remarks that after due deliberations with various stakeholders locally, with educationists to the industry partners, educational institute owners and all that, we have come out with this policy which has been applauded and appreciated by each and everyone. So I see a lot of possibilities engaging, both the country should engage more, because I see hundreds of students going to Canada every year to study. And later on, many of them settle in Canada as well. So our High Commissioner can also look into these areas that which could be the right institutions for India to work together. And it has to be driven by the private sector also. Many things are not forced by the countries. It is with the policies. And if there is a change in the policy and it opens up possibilities, and I think it is up to the industry how they move forward from here.
The last question, sir, I know we have exceeded your time limits, but last question, if you don't mind, there is a little equity investment in Canada, Canadian businesses from Indian investor. One of the areas of growth is for Indian investors to invest in Canadian startups. Is there anything that we can do together to pep this up? In turn, these companies can work in India also in the coming times.
Anilji, any businessman, wherever he will see any opportunity of making a quick buck or more money or a value in future, he doesn't need me and you. They always look for these kind of options. And that is why we see a lot of companies making a lot of value. Look at India. 6 years back, we were nowhere on the startup tag. With the Prime Minister Modi initiative, hand-holding the startup companies, what they want. And the first meeting I had with Prime Minister Modi when I was appointed State for Finance, he told me, address the issue of youngsters, the young Indian entrepreneurs, the startups. And he gave us a timeline of 1 month to address all those issues. And if we have such a focused Prime Minister, and that is why in just 6 years' time, India is among the top startup nations today. And thanks to the young entrepreneurs of India. That is why companies like Paytm, Baiju, Flipkart, Snapdeal, Ola, Oyo have reached thousands of crore rupees in valuation, which companies like Tata, Birlas and others have taken years or decades to have that kind of valuation. These young generation have been very successful do so. So I think it's not me and you, it is their ideas where the people will invest, where they will see a value. And that is how they will generate more value for their companies, for their shares, for their equity. And I'm sure if India and Canada work together, we can have more unicorns, not only the startups, many more unicorns coming from both the countries.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, sir. We have exceeded a little bit of a time limit of time given to us, but I'd like to give a concluding remarks by and word of thanks by Pankaj Bhai, and then we can finish it off, sir. Thank you so much for a wonderful, wonderful Q&A at the same time your presentation.
Anil ji, main aapse skill ka kaam karwane wala hu, main aapko pehle keh raha hu.
Zarur se sir, main karunga aapke liye. Pakki baat hai. That is a promise. And Ajay ji knows me. I try and honor every commitment I make.
Thank you.
Pankaj Bhai, go ahead.
Thank you, Anil Bhai. On behalf of CIF board, its members and scores of supporters while turned in today, I had the great privilege of today to delivering this vote of thanks to Honorable Minister Anurag Thakurji, the rising star in Indian political scene. Young and dynamic Minister Thakur represents not only the aspirations of young India, but also the new generations is capable of. Thakurji, Anurag Thakurji, you are an important member of PM Modi's team, guiding India toward achieving its new goals much faster. We gratefully cherish with an immense pride the time when Honorable Minister, you mentioned Canada-India Foundation in world largest democracy's parliament and applauded our initiatives. We thank you for your sharing with us in detail the many initiatives your government has launched, like Making India, Digital India, and also updating us on the ocean of opportunities in the area of cooperation between Canada and India. Similarly, you splendidly elaborated on PM Modi's vision on Atmanirbhar Bharat. The reforms that are being implemented by the government of India will give more business in the rest of the world, including Canada, to invest and engage with India even more. Once again, we thank you very much for making the time to be part of CI Speaker Series today. We heartily wish you for the best of your health so that you can continue serving Mother India for the long, long years. I also take an opportunity to thank you, Your Excellency High Commissioner of India, Ajay Bisraji, and Consul General India to Toronto, Ms. Apoorva Srivastaji. Canada-India Foundation is reaffirming our commitment to continue working to foster Canada-India relationship. On behalf of all members of CIF and the board of CIF, I thank all the participants who joined today. Kindly stay tuned as we aspire to bring more and more exciting events in the coming days. Dhanyawad, good night, Shubh Ratri to all participants from India, and I wish a wonderful day ahead to all from North America. Namaskar, Dhanyawad.
Namaskar, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mm.